Fantastic. Welcome everybody to church today. And don't you want to turn around or turn to somebody and just say hello, do a Y5 if you want to. Greet them in the way that you like. You know, thank you so much to our team. I appreciate you guys leading us in worship today. Fantastic. And come on, aren't we grateful to ESCOM? Because it just shows us that ain't nothing going to stop the church, amen? You were going to sit at home and read a book, but no, you came to church today, and I'm so grateful. Welcome. We're even so thankful that we get to stream this online right now. So people at home with load shedding aren't going to get this, obviously, but they'll get it later. And so it'll be online later, and just welcome to you guys. And for anybody who is watching online right now, let me know. Let me know how it is you're watching, where you're watching from. I try to look at the comments afterwards, and we're just so thankful that you're joining us online as well today. So we are fantastically in a series at the moment called Mountains Can Move. Mountains Can Move. And what the premise of this whole series really is that with God, nothing is impossible. And that's something we believe, we strongly believe. You know what? I don't want to be the kind of person who goes through life just believing for the things that are possible. I want to go through life with greater faith because I want to see God do a move in my heart. I want to see God do a move in our city. I want to see God do a move in our nation. I want to see impossible things come to pass because that's where God loves to operate. If we can do it all ourselves, why would God ever step in? But God has actually called us to live a faith that is a supernatural kind of faith, which means basically living above the natural situations and circumstances of life. And so that's where we're going today. I just want to apologize. Of course, we've got generators running at the moment outside. So if you get a little bit high in here from the fumes, it's okay. We just ask you to keep the mask. If it gets really loud and rowdy in here, I know that you're excited in the spirit and not in the fumes. Okay? I apologize also for the noise. Can you guys hear me okay at the back there? Thumbs up. Fantastic. That is good. Just to mention that leaders meeting is happening on the 2nd of November. Okay? So it's in less than 2 weeks' time. If you heard December, that's just the PA system. It's on the 2nd of November, and we look forward to having you guys all there. Are you guys ready for church today? Okay, so I found five people who are ready for church today. Online, are you ready for church today? I know it's just blowing up with comments. They're like, yes, can't wait. Ah, smashing the keyboard. Like, are you guys ready for church today? Yeah. Are you going to help me to preach today? Yeah. Good, because I'd really love to make a three-hour message be done in 30 minutes. And you're going to help me with that. So if you're taking notes today, the title of my message is For the City. For the City. Mountains Can Move. Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. I'm going to ask you all to stand, please, at home. I'm asking you to stand as well, just as we honor the reading of God's word. Whatever we honor, we receive value from. And so we want to take special place of honor over the word of the Lord. And so in Jonah chapter 1, going to the Old Testament, chapter 1, verse 1 to 3 and 4:11. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. And we all know how that went. Jonah chapter 4, verse 11. And God speaking to Jonah, and should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and also many animals? Father, I thank you for your word that teaches us that you have a great heart for cities and for our city. Father, I thank you that through the book of Jonah that you have shown us that you have a passion to reach cities with the message of Jesus. Lord, I pray that we would catch your heart for the city today. I pray that we would respond to your call for the city today. And Lord, I ask you that you would enrich us through your word. And Father, make our hearts open and our minds receptive to hear your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you so much. You can take your seats. I really appreciate that. Don't worry, we will not stand for every scripture reading, but that's good. Cities are an important aspect of life. Does anybody here not love the city of Cape Town? That's what I thought. Everybody loves the city of Cape Town. In fact, the city of Cape Town is so amazing, it's so special that God has to send wind just to keep people away from the city of Cape Town. Okay, but we know that there are three or four special days of the year where the wind doesn't blow, and then we just don't go to work. We just do what we need to do, right? We live in a special city, a city that's known all over the world, but cities are an important aspect to life. In fact, people are moving into cities at the moment at an alarming rate. They say that in the near future, there will be more people living in cities than anywhere else around the world. Urbanization is a real thing that is happening. In fact, they're saying that Cape Town as a metropole has 90% urbanization already. People move into cities. Why? Because there's jobs available in cities. There's entertainment in cities. There's healthcare in cities. There's security in cities, right? Even the poor move into cities. They live in cities because of shelter. In fact, cities have amazing benefits. They also have a dark side. Cities have a great draw on idols. People want what the city offers. The idolatry of cities is out there, and people are drawn to it. In fact, many of us are drawn to it. What are the idols of the city? The idols of the city look like sex, money, and power, where I can do what I want. I can fulfill all the desires and the lust of the flesh. I can pursue security through financial gain, and I can have power where I can have the power to make the decisions to do what I want to do. Don't tell me those idols don't have an appeal to you. It draws on all of us. But what we have to discover and learn and know is that only in Christ can those desires actually be met. Where it's not just about sex, but it's about intimacy. It's about security in who we are in Christ and our future. And it is in power. We get power in this life through surrender, not through conquer. Those are the things we find in Christ. But people move to cities for those. In fact, Jonah says, and to the Lord, when he's in the belly of the fish, in Jonah 2, verse 8, he says, those who cling to worthless idols turn away from God's love for them. So people who are in a pursuit of an idol, they are loved by God, cared for by God. But in the pursuit of an idol, we turn away from God and we turn towards the idol. God's wrath does not fall on us because we're like just helpless. No. God's wrath falls on people because they turn away from the love he gave them at first. And so what we're called to do is turn back. That's what repentance is. It's not turning just away from sin, but it's turning towards Jesus, turning back towards his love. And I've developed this question over the last few years. And the question simply goes like this. Can a city be saved? Knowing what we know about a city, knowing that there's great poverty in the city, there's great evils in the city, there's great idols in the city, there's great strongholds over a city. Yes, there is a Christian witness within the city, but can a city be saved? Can a city be saved within a generation? Or is it impossible? I would like to remind us this morning that nothing is impossible with God. Oh, but Sven, I know God can build his church, but can he save a city? And I want to show you that yes, he can. We must have a theology of the city that reflects Scripture and God's desire. Because in Scripture, Jesus is taught that God, his desire is that all people come to the knowledge of Jesus. His desire is that he has authority and dominion over the whole earth. His desire is that when Jesus went to the cross, it's because he so loved the whole world. And so we find in Scripture that wherever people are, the church needs to be, because God desires people. And cities are the greatest concentration of people. I'm not saying that you can't be called to a farmland. Can't say you can't be called to rural towns. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is, for those of us who live in city, we've got to understand that we are called to the city for the benefit of that city. We must develop a theology that says the city, we are here for the city. We are here for God in the city. I love it in this book of Jonah. Literally, please go home and read it. It'll take you 5-10 minutes. It's 4 chapters, 2 pages, and you'll get this big idea of Jonah. Jonah's incredible. I mean, God sends Jonah to a city called Nineveh that is known for the worst hate crimes imaginable. I can't even express the things that they were doing because of present company. But you can just read up about it. It was crazy things that they were doing. And so God calls Jonah to go to Nineveh. And as we know, Jonah doesn't go, "Yes, Lord, your will be done. Let me go and preach the good news to the people who slaughter." Like he didn't do that. What did he do? He's like, "Cool, you want me to go that way? I'm going that way. I'm taking the first ship to Europe." Let's let that simmer a little bit, in a little bit of sauce. Cross the boat. Anyways, he goes off to Tarshish. And we know the story. And for those of you who don't know the story, don't worry. It's very easy. I'll catch you up. What happens is the ship that he climbs onto gets into a massive raging storm. And Jonah goes to sleep. And all the pagans on the boat are going, they're praying to their God. They're picking gods. They're like, "Who's your God? Okay, pray to him. Who's your God? Okay, pray to her. Like, let's just pray. Let's just get, someone's going to save us." And then the captain finds Jonah in the boat, and Jonah says, "Yeah, it's my fault. The storm is my fault. I'm sorry." "Okay, Jonah, what should we do?" "Just chuck me overboard." You would never hear me say that. "Just throw me overboard in the storm." But anyway, they throw him over the board. The storm quietens down. They worship the Lord, and Jonah gets swallowed by a big fish. Not a whale, a big fish. Talk about having a bad day. I wonder how many storms we run into because we're running from God's call in our life. But anyway, that's another message. But he gets swallowed by a big fish. In the belly of the big fish, he repents. And God commands the big fish to vomit him out onto the shore, probably close to Nineveh. Anyway, talk about having a bad day. I don't think he stopped to shower. He went straight to Nineveh. And the Bible records that he walked through Nineveh and for 3 days proclaimed the word of the Lord to the city of Nineveh. It literally went like this. In 40 days, all of Nineveh will be destroyed unless you turn to the Lord. I mean, that's a really positive message. I want you to go to work this week and go, "The word is going to turn this place upside." Like, don't do that. But the word of the Lord came to the Ninevites, and what happened is the whole city repented and turned to the Lord. And the city was saved, and Jonah was not happy about it. He was depressed. He's like, "God, I knew you were abounding in love. God, I knew you were forgiving, and now you've forgiven all these people for what they've done to us." Incredible story. And Timothy Keller writes an amazing book about Jonah and about cities. And he has this quote saying that God isn't saying to Jonah that he should love urban life and experience. He's saying, you don't have to love the experience of the city or living in an urban lifestyle. But he is saying to Jonah, he's asking how Jonah could fail to be moved by the size of the spiritual need. Jonah doesn't want to go preach to the city. But God is saying to Jonah, there are 120,000 people living there who don't know their left from their right. They are lost in spiritual darkness. How can you not be moved by that great spiritual need? Never mind the animals that live in the city. You know, 120,000 is not even the amount of people that live in this Bloberg city area. His heart was moved. In fact, to show you that in other places in Scripture, God really cares about cities. While the Israelites were in Babylon, God sent Jeremiah the prophet in Jeremiah 29, verse 7, and says, "Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. In the New Testament, we find that Paul's strategy for planting churches and spreading the good news of Jesus was to go to the city, to the urban areas, to share the good news of Jesus, because that is where culture is formed. That is where culture is shared. That is where energy happens within the city. That's where art happens. That's where design happens. That's where influence happens within the city, and it flows out into the surrounding regions. In fact, there was a great city in Ephesus, which we'll get to, which was turned upside down. What I'm bringing this all to a point to say is that we are called to go to the city and to love the city as Christ loves us. When I say the city, I don't mean its buildings. I mean its people. That we have a beautiful city, not because we have a mountain that can move. Imagine that, just Cape Town, just Table Mountain. We have a mountain, we have an ocean, we have vineyards, we have sand dunes. Everything within 20 minutes. Talk about how difficult it is to build a church. We live too close to farms, I think. People on their bicycles on a Sunday morning. Anyway. It's not the things of the city that are beautiful. It's actually the people of the city that are beautiful. Because if we just love the city for what it has, it means we're here to use the city for our ends. But God has in fact called us not to use the city for our benefit, but to love the city for their benefit. Is this helping anybody at the moment? Are we okay? Looking at Jonah, and Jonah's an incredible book. And there's three parts in Jonah that I want to highlight to you. First is God's call to the city. The second is our response. And the third is God's grace. I love it in Jonah how the word of the Lord comes to Jonah. It happens in chapter 1 and chapter 3. In fact, chapter 1 and 3 are a mirror of each other. And chapter 2 and 4 are also a mirror of each other. But he says God calls Jonah to go to the city. Firstly, we know that he disobeys the word of the Lord and he runs for his life. But in the second time when God calls him, he responds obediently to the word of the Lord. You've got to understand, church, that today to realize that you and I are called to bless the city of Cape Town and whatever city we live in. Cape Town can be a city for Christ. God's heart is over this city. Yes, God sees all the destruction. God sees all the things that are going wrong. And his heart breaks even more for the city because he wants people to live in wholeness and freedom. He wants people to experience kingdom life. Drugs, addiction, sex, alcohol, abuse of power, all of these things rob from people. But the kingdom has come to bless people. There is a great spiritual darkness over our city. Jesus has established his light in the city called the church to share the news of the kingdom of God. He has called us to the city. He has called you to the city. I want to ask you today, would you take a moment to respond to the call of God in a positive way and not respond to the call of God in a way that causes you to run away? Let me put this a little bit closer to home, and this may hurt somebody, but I'm saying it in love, just to prefix that. I'll look at the camera so that nobody thinks I'm looking at them. I love you guys at home, by the way. If God has called you to live in another part of the world, please be obedient to that. But if we are running away from the call of God to be a blessing to our city and to our nation, I'm just saying that's not God's call for your life. Oh, things are getting so bad. Things are terrible. I've got to go. I've got to escape. That's fine. Escape, but know that you're escaping out of fear that is not led by the Lord. I feel like God's called us to nations. So I'm not saying you shouldn't go to another city. But when you go to that city, you go because God has called you to that city. You go as a response to opportunity. You go to build the kingdom of God. Our time on earth is short. whatever we do in this world is what we experience in the next world. We cannot earn salvation, but what we can do is we can love cities, we can be there for the good of the city, we can be there to honor the Lord. And so when we go to heaven, there are people in heaven because of our contribution, and our rewards are in heaven based on what we have done on earth as a response to faith. You are not called to build a business for business sake. You are called to build a business for kingdom's sake. You are not called to teach students in a school or a college for teaching's sake. You are called to teach in a school, in a college, in a classroom for kingdom's sake. God has called you. And if you will respond to the call, we will see impossible things happen. We will see revival in our generation. And the second one is our response. What will your response be? It's amazing to me because when Jonah goes onto the boat, he's on a boat with pagans, people who like serve other gods. And what happens is because of this mighty storm, this huge upheaval, what happens is they freak out and they start praying to their gods. God, save us. Whoever, somebody save us. And Jonah's like, he doesn't even want to tell them. He's going to go sleep. And eventually they get onto it that it's Jonah, and Jonah's got to fess up here. He's got to confess what has happened here. And at the preaching of Jonah's word, that boat repents and worships the Lord after they've chucked him off the boat. Because salvation had come to them. So he didn't want to preach to them. Now fast forward to when he goes to Nineveh. He doesn't want to preach to the Ninevites either. But when he does go and preach to the Ninevites, they repent and they get saved. And the city is spared from destruction. Our response, church, is so, so important. Because God is saying to us, can you not see the spiritual need of the people around us? And if we go, yeah, I can see it, I just don't care, which is, I know there's nobody here. Or I see it, but I don't know what to do about it. And so I rather run from it. We will not see God move in the city. But if we will say yes, yes to the Lord, yes to his call, we will see him move in our city. The third part is God's grace. And I love this one especially because you would never expect being swallowed by a fish to be God's grace. Now don't get caught up if it was a fish, if it was a story or whatever. But the point is, Jonah is repenting to the Lord in the belly of the fish. He's like, God, I'm so sorry. Thank you that in the depths, even there, you have heard me. And so he rescues him. He used the fish so that God could show Jonah the grace on his life, the grace that God extended to him. And then after Jonah goes and preaches to the city, God teaches him about having grace towards other people. And the point of that narrative is this, is that we have received the grace of God in our life. He has changed our life. He has set us free. He has set us apart. He has given us a hope and a future. He has given us family called the church. He has given us a new creation that we look forward to. He has given us everything we need in Christ Jesus. So we are now called to love other people with the same kind of grace. To love as we have been loved. It's hard to win a city you don't care about. And when I say that, I mean people. So I want us to respond to God's grace, to respond to God's call, and to go. Nineveh repented in 3 days, and God's concern for a city was for 120,000 people. I was reading up last night that the city of Cape Town, estimate population in 2021 is 4.7 million people. Cape Town City, not the Western Cape, Cape Town City, 4.7 million people. It's a little bit more than Nineveh, okay? Wow, that was way funnier. I was like, come on. Come on. Online, they're just laughing. They're like LOLs and like smiley faces, tears coming out their eyes. In 1950, the population of Cape Town was 618,000. In the next 10 to 15 years, the UN estimates that the city will grow by another 1 million people. So don't worry necessarily about going to the nations. The nations are coming here. We should still go to nations, but God has put us in a place where people are coming every single day. Families are moving every single day. And you know what's scary about that statistic? Is that the church's witness is not growing at the same rate. Which means the percentage of Christians in our city is dropping. That is a great concern to me. That is terrible news. Can you believe that I'm having this conversation yesterday and they might be watching online. Can you believe that in schools they're advocating for same-sex bathrooms? Can you believe that they want to pass these laws? Can you believe that they want to do that? Yes, I can believe that, because more people in the city don't know Jesus than those who do know Jesus. So what kind of laws do you think people are going to pass? I'm not saying that everyone needs to be saved, although that's my heart. But what I'm saying is the witness of the church for Jesus Christ must grow at the rate of the city at least. Our hearts need a turn. But Sven, it's impossible. No, nothing is impossible. The mountain that needs to be moved is the mountain that's in our heart that says, I'm here for me and my family, and that's it. No, you are here for your workplace. You are here for your school. You are here for your running group, your cycling group, your spinning class. For God, for people, for the city. Because God's compassion over this city is big. And I actually have to repent, because my heart has not been broken for our city. It's only been the last 2 years that God has been putting it on our heart for the city. For the city, for the city. And at that moment, I decided we are not here for a suburb. We are here for a city. It doesn't matter where we have a building. We are here for the city, not a suburb. We will love our suburbs as part of the city, but we are here for the city. And if you haven't heard it yet, today you will hear it. We are making a declaration that we, View Church Sunningdale, this congregation, are here for the city of Cape Town and whatever cities he may lead us to. In other nations, God has called us to nations, but specifically cities in other nations. But we have to do it here first. And so you might have heard it, I don't know, but we are dreaming with you and with God for 5 churches in the next 5 years, because we are making a stand for our city. We want to go at the pace that he allows us to go. That is our vision. We must be moved by what moves the heart of God. And the city is moving God's heart. And he has called us to answer the call. Our vision is to play a role to win the city for Christ, for revival in our generation. And the funny thing about revival is like a spark. It only needs to ignite, and it will run through the city. That's why we pray on a Wednesday morning. If you don't know, we pray on Zoom every Wednesday morning at 7 a.m. If you want to jump on there, we'll put it up on our website, but it's on our Facebook page. And also, I want you to know that the miracle offering that we're taking up next week is not so that our church can be a bigger church. It's not so that our church can have more money. It's so that our church can be for the city, that our church can plant churches in the city, so that our church can buy a building in the city, that our church can do ministry within the city. Our dream is that in a calendar year, we could give away R1 million in social justice and foreign missions. We are here for the city. I'm making a stand. We are here for the city. And so when we come together next week into our miracle offering, it's not, please, I don't want you to feel any compulsion. We've never tried to put anything on people to give. We're just inviting you to give as a response to what God has done for you, and a response to say, hey, okay, God, I'm going to believe you, and I'm going to bring what I have. Our miracle offering is not a number goal. It's a participation goal. I'm praying that everyone, if it's R5, it's R5. But I'm praying that everyone will bring something so that we can say, God, we are for the city all together. Amen. Is that okay? Can I share that? Can a city be saved? Yes. But without God, it cannot happen. And we need God. I want to share a song story with you. It's a song I started listening to in the last few days. An old song called God of the City. It's played by Chris Tomlin, but it was actually written by Aaron Boyd of Blue Tree. How's that for an old name? Blue Tree. An Irish band. And they were in the church. And I want to share the song story with you, and then I'll give you a chance to hear it. Pretty much their missions director asked them, hey, could you go to Thailand, to Bangkok, Thailand, on a missions trip as a band? And they're like, yeah, we'll do it. I mean, who doesn't want to go and travel? So they go into it. But as they say, is that it is like the tourist sex capital of the world. And it's a broken city. And so they actually ended up playing in a brothel. And then they got invited to play in a bar called the Climax Bar. And as he says this, as he's recounting this story, Aaron Boyd, he's saying they ended up playing in that bar. And over his shoulder, he noticed some tourists outside. He didn't know what nationality, although he thought they were British. And he says he wondered what they must have thought. All of these Jesus songs blaring out of this bar in the middle of Bangkok, Thailand, thinking, what on earth are those guys doing in that bar playing this kind of music? It kind of feels awkward, doesn't it? Like, you want to go there to sin, except Jesus keeps sharing, like, his name? Like, have you ever sinned and prayed at the same time? Praying people don't sin, sinning people don't pray, right? And it's just, that's what's happening. Like, I've never consciously sinned while listening to worship music. Just putting it out there. And he said that, like, he felt like God gave him a song in that moment. A song for the city. And they started playing it softly, and it built up into an anthem. And it was, you're the God of the city. You're the king of these people. You are the Lord of this nation. You are. Powerful songs to sing in the middle of brokenness. And he recounts to say, what is the church on a global scale doing to actually combat things which exist on our planet that are completely wrong? Whether it's child soldiers, prostitution in the city, homelessness in the city, or anything that's going on, what is the church doing? We are called to be pioneers, to stand up for the kingdom of God, not to condemn the city, but to love the city, to serve the city, and to be a witness for Jesus in the city. So we're going to play a lyric video, and this is really a time of reflection for us to go, God, what are you saying to me about the city that I'm in? Online, maybe you're visiting. What are you saying to me? To reflect, to listen, and to pray. And then I'll conclude the message. Thank you.
You're the God of this city, you're the king of these people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless, you are. There is no one like our God. Is no one like our God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of this people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like I.
You know, the only reasonable response I can think of is say, God, please, please would you come? Please would you come into our city? God, would you move in our city? Breathe upon our city. Pour out salvation on our city. That's my prayer. And I love it. Greater things are still to be done in this city. More churches are still to be planted in this city. Schools are going to turn around for Christ in this city. Businesses are going to be a place of justice in our city. For profit, but for kingdom. For profit, yes, but for the good of the city. The jobs will be provided for in our city. Greater things are to be done in our city. And who is God going to use? Us. I mean, if he would use someone who didn't want to go there in the first place, and the only thing he said reluctantly was like, you better turn or burn. Like, how much more would God use us? You think we have to have this great skill? No, we just have to have a heart and a faith to believe God for our city, that mountains can move. God is inviting us, church, into the greatest story ever written, the salvation of a city and cities of the world, that they would come to know Jesus. A great outpouring is coming, and God is asking you what role you're going to play. I'm not giving you something more to do. I'm just saying, be who you are with a heart that has faith for the city that God's planted you in. Don't isolate yourself, but go to the city, to love the city as Christ loves us. You know, in this story, as I close, we actually see that Jesus is the true Jonah. in the story. It's not about us going to the city like Jonah went to the city, because most of us say no and we try to grab onto the next ship that's going to Tarshish. But what we do know is that Jesus, after hearing the call of God, his Father, to go to the world, responded with yes, at the cost of his own life. At great personal sacrifice, at great personal cost, it was Jesus that went to proverbial Nineveh to preach the kingdom of heaven has come, to bring an invitation of salvation to all who would believe. I don't know about you, but I remember where Jesus found me, where I was in Nineveh, where I was serving other gods, where I was living for my own sake and for my own benefit, where I was lost in my brokenness with nowhere to go, where I was didn't know my left from my right. But I remember where Jesus found me that day at Tableview High School when a few people from a church came to preach the good news of Jesus. And I thought, they said, oh, do you believe in Jesus? And I stood up and I realized that nobody else was standing up except for one other person. But then I walked out because I didn't want to back out. And then they explained the news of Jesus and I broke down because I realized that it wasn't a religion, but Jesus is a person who loves me, who paid a price of his own life for me and has invited me into a kingdom that is eternal, a kingdom full of love, a kingdom full of hope, a kingdom full of peace, a kingdom full of joy, one that will always be going. And I realized that my sin wasn't going to keep me out, because he paid that price. Jesus did what Jonah didn't do in the beginning. He responded to the call and went. But what Jesus is inviting us into, because of the grace we've received from him, is, will you follow me into the city so that other people can experience the life that you have in Christ? Can we pray? Father, I thank you that you have sent Jesus into the world to bring us into your kingdom. For you so loved the world that you sent Jesus. Father, I pray that we would so love this city that we would also send Jesus and follow him into the highways and the byways, to the workplaces, the schools, the media centers, the culture drivers, that we can be a light in darkness. Father, I pray that you would move our hearts, that we wouldn't scoff at the thought of a city being saved, but that our hearts would be ignited with excitement to believe that just maybe in our generation, Cape Town could be a city for Christ, that cities, wherever you've planted us in, could be lanterns for the good news. They would spread all over the world. And Father, I thank you for your grace that we have received. Just with every eye closed and head bowed, I just want to offer an invitation to you and online as well, that if you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior and you're spiritually lost, seeking answers, I want to invite you into a personal relationship with him where you would know where you're going. You would know the purpose of your life is to live with God. God wants to forgive you of your sin because he loves you. Bible teaches that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But he loves you so much that he wants to restore a relationship with himself, with you. And even after all we've done, even after all of your sin, and he wants to invite you into that because he has sent Jesus to forgive you. He laid down his own life so that we could experience life. And in that moment, the Bible teaches that if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Not just saved from hell or a lost eternity, but saved for a purpose, saved for good works, saved for an eternal life with Jesus. When he restores and renews all things, you will be there experiencing life abundantly. And that life can start today. If you would just repent and say, I'm sorry, God, for my sin, and I want to follow Jesus. It's not a call for perfection. It's a call for an honest reflection and a turning to the Lord. And if that's you online, or if that's you in the building today, I just want to pray for you. I'm not going to call you up. I'm just going to say, hey, could you let me know who I'm praying for by shooting up your hand? At home, you can do the same, or type in the comments like hand raised, or hit the button that says, hey, I want to give my life to Jesus today. If that's you today, I just want to know that I'm praying for you, that you would walk out of here in a right relationship with God. We never know how much time we have, but you have this moment. And if that's you, I just want to pray for you. So if you just stick your hand real high and give you a moment to do that. Awesome. Okay. Father, I just thank you so much. I thank you so much, God, for the gift of Jesus Christ. And I thank you for those who are putting their faith in you today. Father, I ask that you would move into their hearts as they repent of their sin and turn to you, and they would experience abundant and overflowing joy all the days of their life, and that they would follow you all the days of their life. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.